Our first reading comes from Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to devour my flesh, my adversaries and foes, they shall stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war rise up against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I asked of the Lord, that I will seek after, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord, and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will set me high on a rock. Now my head is lifted up above my enemies all around me, and I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. Come, my heart says, seek his face. Your face, Lord, do I seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger, you who have been my help. Do not cast me off. Do not forsake me, O God of my salvation. If my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will take me up. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. Do not give me up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they are breathing out violence. I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord.
Amen. Thank you so much. Our epistle reading is taken from 1 Corinthians, chapter 1, verses 10 to 18. Paul writes, "Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you should be in agreement, and that there should be no divisions among you, but that you should be united in the same mind and the same purpose. For it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there are quarrels among you, my brothers and sisters. What I mean is that each of you says, I belong to Paul, or I belong to Apollos, or I belong to Cephas, or I belong to Christ. Has Christ been divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Or were you baptized in the name of Paul? I thank God that I baptized none of you except Crispus and Gaius, so that no one can say that you were baptized in my name. I did baptize also the household of Stephanas. Beyond that, I do not know whether I baptized anyone else. For Christ did not send me to baptize, but to proclaim the gospel, and not with eloquent wisdom, so that the cross of Christ might not be emptied of its power. For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So last Sunday, it was such a gift to have the executive director of Alliance for Interfaith Ministries, AIM, here at South Plains for the Agape Lunch conversation. And she shared wonderful news about AIM and what it does in Albemarle County and Charlottesville, and really in many ways in other parts of the community. AIM was founded 40 years ago when several congregations came together from different denominations so that efforts to support people in need could be coordinated. Almost 20 years ago, South Plains started its support of AIM. Congregations that are very different from one another are able to support more people in a more meaningful way by partnering for a common purpose of helping our neighbors. I'm just trying to see if I, should I stop? Okay, all right. I'm sorry, we were just making sure that everyone could hear on Zoom. So we can do more together by partnering around a common purpose. Different understandings of God's call and mission are as old and probably even older than the very first Christian churches that ever were here. It's clear to most readers of 1 Corinthians and very clear to biblical scholars that the community of new followers of Christ that was in that first century Corinth disagreed about a lot of things, how the Lord's Supper should be celebrated and how often, who should be leaders, what to do about food that had been sacrificed to idols but shouldn't be wasted, how marriage might be different for these new followers of Christ than it had been in their own cultural traditions, which was in this case deeply Greek influenced. Corinth was a big city, as I said, heavily influenced by Greek culture or Hellenistic culture. The fact that Paul had to write 2 Corinthians, that second letter, shows that the arguments kind of continued. This letter didn't solve all the disagreements that were in that early church community. The opening reading for today started with verse 10, and that reads, "Now I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you should be in agreement and that there should be no divisions among you, but that you should be united in the same mind and the same purpose." That phrase, the same purpose, is what led me to think about last Sunday, and in particular, the ministry of AIM, Alliance for Interfaith Ministry. Their mission is to help residents of Albemarle County and Charlottesville attain self-sufficiency and stability through direct assistance with housing, utility, and crises on behalf of an approved client. In other words, the funds go to landlords and utility companies and the like. Clients are never provided cash or checks. The diverse congregations and people who support the wonderful mission of AIM disagree about a lot of things. They have different perspectives, but they are united in the same, they're not necessarily united in the same mind, but they are definitely united in the same purpose and do great work. Now, while Paul does spend a lot of time in this letter telling the Corinthian church folks how wrong they are about many things, it can be tiresome. None of us wants to be told all the time, you're doing that wrong and you're doing this wrong. But it is not all finger wagging, so to speak. He starts out the letter with the usual greeting, which was common at that time. Bob, I'm confused. Oh, I'm sorry. So while Paul does spend a lot of time in his letter telling the Corinthian church how wrong they are about many things, it's not all about finger wagging. He starts out the letter with this usual greeting of grace and peace, and in verse 4, Paul writes to this ragtag community of believers, "I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that has been given to you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift." So even though they are divided about some things, God has given them the spiritual gifts that are needed to answer God's call. And I believe that that is true of most groups and congregations working to answer God's call. There may be differences about how to act and when to act, but God has given communities the gifts they need to move forward. Of course, just as the giving of spiritual gifts still happens today, disagreement in churches and denominations is still happening. Thankfully, I don't think it happens a whole lot here. But it's still happening, and still God is calling us to find a way through, to be united in the same mind and the same purpose. I read an article this week in last month's Presbyterian Today entitled Changing the World, One Word and One Act at a Time. It mentioned a congregation named St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church in Raleigh, North Carolina, which is a large congregation of about 800 members. And those members often have different political or cultural perspectives. So apparently in 2020 and 2021, there was a lot going on, as you know, in the world and in Raleigh. So they invited folks from within this diverse congregation who had differing points of view. They invited them to the same table to reflect together on how they could act to make a difference in their local community. And their pastor said, "People are willing to work and support one another when the congregation is led by theology rather than ideology." St. Andrew's in Raleigh is like Alliance for Interfaith Ministries and other organizations and congregations that manage to work for a common purpose across lines of perhaps cultural or political or even sometimes theological difference to find the same purpose, God's purpose. Another aspect of what those believers in Corinth appear to have been arguing about is their allegiance to different leaders. I belong to Paul. I belong to Apollos. I belong to Cephas, who is Peter. I belong to Christ. This is what Paul writes. Now, of course, it's human nature for us to click with some people more than others, to have perhaps a shared experience that is powerful and leaves a lasting impact with one person versus another. In the church in Corinth, however, this kind of human nature was leading to division. While Paul is often pretty forthright when he tells people a lot in his letters, "Listen to me, not those other people." But in this case, he's not putting himself forward as the one to follow so much, although that might be part of his intent. He says that the one to follow is, of course, Christ. So he says, "Has Christ been divided? It is Christ who died and rose again, not Paul. We are baptized in Christ's name, not in the name of Paul or Peter or Apollos." Leaders like Peter and Paul and this Hellenistic preacher, which I'd never really heard of, named Apollos, had to have been very effective speakers. And apparently, biblical scholars think that Apollos was very effective, and he was trained in the Greek rhetoric of the time, and so he was a little bit threatening to Paul. So anyway, they must have been very great orators, and they drew people to Christ, and God worked through them to draw people to Christ. But, as sometimes happens, God uses people this way, but the problem is that we can sometimes fixate on the messenger more than the message. So I guess I spent more time than usual reading Christian magazines this week because the cover story of another recent issue of Sojourners magazine caught my eye. That cover story title is "The Trouble with Christian Heroes." At the heart of that article were two questions. What is the place of the charismatic leader? And how do movements pick up the pieces when charismatic leaders commit abuse? It's written by a woman whose faith was renewed and inspired by the work and mission and life of Jean Vanier. In my third, I had to look it up. In my third month here as pastor in the fall of 2021, I mentioned in a sermon the L'Arche community in France that was founded, or at least co-founded, by the late Jean Vanier. These communities, 147 of them all over the world, I think in over 35 countries, these communities are havens where adults with and without mental disabilities live with each other in community. Residents learn so much from each other about what love is by living in community. L'Arche, the word L'Arche in French is what we would in English say is the ark. And these communities really are a refuge, and they rescued many, many people, especially when they first began in the 1960s, from terrible conditions in psychiatric facilities of the day. And in many ways, they've helped deinstitutionalize care for people with developmental disabilities all over the world for the decades since the 60s. So understandably, Jean Vanier became a hero to many people, including myself and including the woman who wrote this article. He has been honored with all kinds of awards, including the French Legion of Honor, which is a very big deal. The problem is, after Vanier's death in 2019, so it wasn't that long ago, six non-disabled women credibly reported that Vanier had used his role as leader to engage in manipulative sexual relationships with them. All of the women were L'Arche assistants, in other words, residents, to whom Vanier was supposed to be offering spiritual direction. So in the space of a few months, the hero of the story became the villain. As happened a lot in the news a few years ago, we all remember all these wonderful people who we thought were just wonderful, and they turned out to be abusive. So the author says the good guy becomes the bad guy. It is particularly painful when the hero, in many ways, is doing amazing Christian work. This is one reason abuse by clergy is especially tragic, a terrible violation of trust, of course, and a possible negation of what otherwise is sometimes wonderful work. The L'Arche communities are still continuing to discern how to rebuild trust and community in the wake of these abuse revelations about Jean Vanier. As a way to free the powerful and important story of L'Arche from being about only one hero turned villain, the author of this article reframes the co-founding story of L'Arche through the eyes of the surviving, or at least as of a year ago, still surviving original resident with Jean Vanier, and there was another disabled man that began living with him in 1964 and began what would become L'Arche. The author emphasizes that the story of L'Arche is really told not by about one person, but by all the people who live in L'Arche communities and experience relationships that show God's love lived in humility. Recalling Paul's words in Corinthians, we can hope that they all moved from feeling perhaps like I belong to Vanier to I belong to Christ. Turning to Psalm 27, when we read these powerful and rich verses, we may not think about fallen heroes or even Christian communities per se. It speaks so many words of consolation and hope. The first verse alone is just beautiful and has brought comfort and inspiration to generations and generations of people. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? remembering what we've been reflecting on for the past few Sundays, like the Magi of Epiphany, and like those first disciples of Jesus who were John's disciples, there is language in Psalm 27 about seeking God. That inherently human longing to find and spend time with God. This is especially acute when life is challenging, when enemies are at the door, metaphorical enemies or real enemies are at the door. And verses 7 and 8, "Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud, be gracious to me and answer me. Come, my heart says, seek his face. Your face, Lord, do I seek." The verse is echoed, that verse in particular, echoed as I reflected this week on communities and leaders. And verse 10 also of 27, Psalm 27, "If my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will take me up." In Corinth, Paul might have adapted Psalm 27 this way: "If Paul or Apollos or Peter forsake me, the Lord will take me up." In communities with disgraced leaders, they might say, "If Vanya forsakes me, the Lord will take me up." When we look to Christ, instead of any one particular human leader, we can work across differences. It's the Lord who is our light and our salvation. When we put God at the center, we can work with people who differ from us. We can move beyond allegiance to a particular personality to allegiance to the one who will never forsake us. Thanks be to God. Amen.